Hey, hello guys, welcome back to Let's Play ChäoS Head. I replayed through the game because I couldn't stop myself from doing so because I really wanted to see how this goes. And I was scrolling through this at high speed by pressing control, which just lets you skip through the entire game. And basically to get to this point I needed to do all the, whatchamacallit, the right triggers. So I had to follow a guide to do the triggers by Lord Rachel on Game Facts. Thank you. And I noticed that this seems to be different from what I had in my last playthrough. So hey, let's take a look. Basically, in my last playthrough, let me open it here. It said Aoi Senna stepped onto the platform supporting Orihara Kozue. And here we have Aoi Senna stepped onto the platform carrying Orihara Kozue on her back. So let's see what happens. There had been no need for her to buy a ticket. She didn't spot any station workers anywhere, and the ticket machines were out of service too. When she looked at the tracks, the rails were visibly warped. Naturally, the trains had been at a standstill since yesterday. Kozue's breathing began to sound painful from time to time, but she wasn't conscious. There was dried blood plastered on her forehead. During the earthquake, she'd been caught among the collapsing buildings and hadn't woken since. Gigalomaniacs couldn't use their power to heal their own wounds. Pain compelled them to be reminded of the reality of their injuries. They couldn't create local shared recognition to the effect of, I'm not wounded. They couldn't make it as if nothing had happened. Their human instincts wouldn't permit it. Which was to say, nothing of the fact that one couldn't construct local shared recognition with the other person was unconscious. Senna could now do nothing to help Kozue. Upon reaching the depopulated platform, Senna lowered Kozue from her back and leaned her gently up against the wall. Her expression was harsh. She gave the lowered Kozue only a single glance, then soon shifted her gaze back to the station premises, and glaring at a certain fixed point, she ground her teeth together.
Yatta. Mitsuketa.
At the end of her line of sight, two human figures stood lined up at the back of the dim platform. One was a tall man wearing a high-quality suit. From head to toe, he gave off an aura of refinement. He had excellent posture, and a relaxed smile played about his lips. The other was a homeless man clad in filthy clothing. His hair was overly long, and his face had been left unshaven. Since he had his head lowered, it was impossible to be certain of his expression. The two of them had overly contrasting appearances. All they did was stand quietly in this dark station platform, where there were no other people. To Senna, both of them were objects of hatred, Norosugenichi and Hatanoise. Even if she wanted to forget them, she wouldn't have been able to. In the past, her mother and her little sister had met with a gruesome end before her eyes, and these people themselves were the culprits who had killed Senna's family. The homeless man, Hatano, murmured desolately, his head hanging. Hatano took a darting glance at Norris's countenance. Norris said nothing. His attitude of being utterly at ease remained impeccable.
この男が実験の継続を指示した。私はあの結果を望んではいなかった。
Senna felt revolted as she listened to his words of repentance.
お前は母さんと妹を見殺しにした。それが厳然とした事実だ。悔いているならどうして逃げた。世界を守るためだ。
親に逆らうのは感心しませんね。
There, for the first time, Noruse spoke.
確かに、君の家族が悲劇的な結末を迎えたのは、私が指示した結果です。もう十分データは取れていたのでね。実に有意義な実験でした。
有意義？
She swiftly rebooted her D-sword. The shockwave from it stirred her long dark hair.
この男を殺せセナ。こいつが元凶だ。
言われなくても。
Senna had already leapt powerfully from the platform floor. She closed the distance without brandishing her sword. Whew! A wondrous demonstration of springing into motion from a standstill. Her target was Noruse Genichi. She mowed him down with her D-sword, slicing apart even the air. His head went flying. Senna followed it with her eyes. Noruse's soaring head abruptly warped mid-air. She watched it transform into her own father's face. Shocked, she looked at the headless body before her. It had been wearing a suit a second before, but now it was in a hopeless person's tattered clothes. Powerless, it went toppling over backwards. Eyes wide, Senna moved her gaze to Hatano, who had been standing beside it. He, in turn, faced her as well. His bearded mouth had on a mocking smile, his face contorted as though a mosaic had been laid over it. His body contorted too. The next instant, Hatano had assumed the face of a man Senna didn't know. In age, countenance, and demeanor, he was a completely different person from her father. Senna was bewildered. She took another scrutinizing look at the head she had just decapitated. After tracing an arc and falling, it had splattered blood over the floor. It was her father's face, her father's head. Senna couldn't tear her eyes away from it. Bewitchment brought about by delusion. As she came to that realization, Senna's breathing went fast and shallow.
Senna-chan, sa.
The man who had previously supposed to have been her father was now a separate person. Called Senna's name in an intimate tone.
君が今やったことって結局お父さんと同じっすよね。
It was the result she'd longed for these past 6 months. It should have been. Despite that, Senna was assaulted by uncertainty. Her father, now only a head, had his eyes turned in Sean's direction. Sean? Sua, I guess? Or Senna? Senna, yeah, Senna.
父親の首跳ねて殺すって、えぐいな。
と、さ。
Why was she experiencing this much psychological shock? Still not understanding the reason behind it, Senna heard the sound of something tearing apart with a snap deep in her ears. I heard a voice. It was a scream in Senna's heart. Upon hearing that cry, which resembled madness and seemed to curse reality, I came running to Shinsen Station. But by then, it was already too late. When I entered the dim premises, the faint smell of blood hovered in the air. Kozuki was lying down by the wall, unconscious. And on the platform, there was Senna's form, sunken down and her back facing me. Her head was lowered, making her long hair cover her face, keeping me from seeing her expression. Next to her was a headless body. The round object, lying fallen on a short distance away, was the head that had once been connected to the corpse, I realized. Hatano-san. Becoming aware that it was him, I bit my lip.
こいつはラッキーっすね。
The old man stood on the tracks. Though he was in a suit, he also wore a rucksack, and from within it, it reverberated a nasty mechanical noise. Suwa Mamoru, a detective in the investigative department at police headquarters. I had met this man before, and I knew what this man had done.
もともとは目障りなハタの親子を処分しに来たんすけどね。西条くん、君が自分から火に飛び込んできてくれて感謝感激っす。
Alright, I'll meet you guys back when the stuff changes again. Until then, let's keep playing actually. It might change since... This entire scene has been different.
君を見かけたら捕まえろってことになってるんすよ。
誰に？
内緒っす。
A flippant smile, that way of smiling brought his late partner Detective Bun to mind. But there was one decisive difference between them. Detective Bun's smile had been a performance, meant to set the other person off guard, or else irritate them. When it came to Sue, on the other hand, the sly smile itself was his true nature.
あんたは、ノロセの居場所を知ってる？
西条君さ。
Sue shook his head exaggeratedly and let out a sigh.
口の聞き方に気をつけてほしいっすね。自分の方が年上っすよ。
Without taking my eyes off Sue, I cautiously jumped for the platform and down onto the tracks. It ended up so that I was shielding the motionless Senna with my back.
アンっていう人を殺したのはあんただ。
だから。
Yeah, it looks like it's not changing. I'm gonna save and I'll scroll forward a bit more and we'll see what happens. All right?Until then, guys. Until then. Guess fucking what? I scrolled a bit further on ahead, it instantly changed. So let's keep going.
刑事のくせに人を殺すなんて。
君には言われたくないっす。
I clenched my D-sword tightly.
あんたみたいなやつに敬語を使う義理なんてないよ。
あのさ、お前に言われたくねえって言ってるんだよ。
I could tell clearly, even from this distance, the smile had disappeared from Sua's face.
お前も人殺しだろ。違うとは言わせないぞ。お前は、葉月氏のを殺した。俺は今すぐにでも、お前をぶち殺したいんだよ。
Oh, Shino is probably his girlfriend. Hazuka Shino, the nurse who had been the new true Jin criminal. The two of them were fellow disciples of the Church of God's Light. Was that all there was to it? I gulped down a breath.
信仰の救いのために、それは自制するが。その代わり、俺が責任持って心を殺してやる。
I immediately started to brandish my D-sword.Nothing was going to come of brandishing it, though. I'd simply done it on reflex, and just as expected, it didn't make any difference. Here we go. This is entirely different. All of a sudden, an astoundingly powerful wind blew at me. Pushed back by it, I almost fell over. So I desperately braced myself. But my body didn't go through with it, and instead I curled up in a ball on the spot.I couldn't control my own body. It moved by itself, like it didn't belong to me. Before I knew it, my surroundings had gone dark. Below me was a nighttime vista that one might easily mistake for a field of stars. I came to the realization that I was standing somewhere incredibly high up. Beside me were four guys and girls I'd never met. No, I'd seen one of them before. Yua. For some reason, she wasn't wearing her glasses.Oh, this is like the suicide scene her sister was in fault with that we saw in chapter 9 and even earlier, I believe. Forgive me, this let's play took place over 8 years, so I really don't fucking know anymore. No, not Yua. She was Mia, Yua's younger twin sister, who should have died a month ago. In other words, this was, the roof of Cornelius Tower. And my body wasn't my own.I was wearing an unfamiliar school uniform. Even my stature was more brawny. To begin with, I could guess who I was based on the fact that there were only four other guys and girls near me, crumpled down, petrified, wailing and crying. This body into which my consciousness had climbed. It belonged to one of the five victims who had died in the first new gen case, the group dive. Without my will having any bearing on it,My field of sight slowly moved. It slid to the side. I turned back toward the heliport. Shogun, who had filmed that video, must be there. Shogun wore a dark spider helmet on his head and a black cloak over his body. The shogun who'd cornered me at the O front had put on a similar getup. But was he really shogun? No. No matter how I looked at it, his legs, sticking out slightly from beneath the black cloak, were clad in slacks. On top of that, they were as thick as those of a regular adult male. They weren't the skinny, pitiful legs of shogun of Nishijo Takumi, whose bones protruded visibly. Looking more closely, even his seated height was totally different. The cloak kept him hidden, but his shoulders also appeared fairly broad. At the very least, he wasn't Nishijo Takumi. Nor was he carrying a video camera. Moreover, from the darkness spreading out to the fake shogun's back, I heard dragging footsteps. And not just one set of them. It wasn't a hallucination. Those peculiar footsteps belonged to many, many people. It meant that a several dozen somethings were lurking beyond the darkness. These footsteps hadn't been a part of a video uploaded on YouTube. Besides, there was no way such a large number of people could have accessed this heliport. What the hell was the source of this sound? The four others next to me screamed and wept in lamentation. Disregarding my will, my body too let out a cry and began shaking. Something was approaching. But that was only what happened in movies. A mob of zombies couldn't possibly show up in reality. Much less than 21st century Tokyo. So what about it? My chest seemed about to cave in with fear. I wanted to look away, but the owner of the body that I'd entered wasn't averting his eyes. At last, those unknown beings began to emerge from the darkness. They flooded the heliport, sealing off our escape route. I didn't know whether to describe this. As getting the wind knocked out of my sails, what appeared were perfectly ordinary people. If you overlooked a single point, out of the nearly 100 people there, every one of them was holding a bladed weapon. None of them said a word. They simply wove a dissonant melody, made up of mingling of their numerous wild nasal breaths. For some reason, I couldn't see their expressions too well. It was like all of their faces were made out of a paint blurred by water. Their faces were vague, disintegrating. Were their faces truly deformed? Or else, had my sight watching them had gone off kilter? I couldn't tell. With lethargic but uncertain steps, they were coming our way, like robots ordered onward by a single program. I thought maybe the fake shogun was giving them orders, but he didn't appear to be doing so. Once in a while, he moved his wheelchair forward a tiny bit, and afterwards, he didn't budge an inch. The five young people being driven back had nowhere to run in order to escape from this incredibly high place. Whew. My God. Hello? 180 meters above ground. Holding their blades, the crowd approached, little by little, bit by bit. They'd already closed the distance to the point. Still silent even at this final stage, drawing near us without attempting to leap upon us all at once. The horde moved around bizarrely, but as a result seemed far more dreadful, enough to make me think I want to get out of here right away, even if it meant jumping off.
Sono me. Dare no me.
Oh, it is shogun. The voice I heard unexpectedly, it was one of the real shogun, Nishijo Takumi. But I heard it not from the direction of shogun, but wearing a dark spider helmet, but rather from straight overhead. Apparently, I hadn't been the only one to hear it. The five of us were being hunted down, stood up as if we'd received our cue, joined hands with each other and looked up at the night sky. Naturally, all that spread out there was a starscape, but I didn't see Shogun anywhere. He'd been looking in on our thoughts. My field of sight slowly panned across, and mysteriously enough, although the night scenery of Shibuya ought to have been spreading out below me, a long flight of stairs stretched out there, a building standing close beside Cornelius Tower. Despite the fact that nothing of the sort existed in reality, holding each other's hands, it was exactly how the group dive incident had concluded. They hadn't taken a dive because they wanted to. When the stairs, which they utterly convinced themselves were there, turned out not to exist and the sensation of beginning to fall shocked them, they shrieked, oh my god, too fucking fast. Woo! All five slamming into the ground were crushed with a crunching sound. The pain of it grabbed hold of me without my expecting it. That single blow leading straight to death. Its impact made it seem like my entire body had exploded and been ground down into a fine powder from the inside out. I experienced the sensation of my heart contracting violently from the shock of it, and my consciousness was caught off there. Well then, my eyes were coercively made to open, and the scenery flew into my vision without my consent. I was walking along Tamagawa Street. My body was completely intact, even though the previous sensation of colliding with the ground lingered distinctly within me. I was walking normally down the street, not that what I willed had anything to do with it. This body too was sturdier than mine. This wasn't me either. I had a nasty premonition. Oh. Suddenly there was a strange man walking toward me. When I saw him, I was forced to acknowledge that my hunch had been right on the money. The man I had passed was clothed in a suit, but for some reason he wore a Darth Spider helmet on his head. The image he made was much too surreal. There were no other passerby. I wanted to flee from here at this very second. Despite that, the owner of the body, my consciousness had come in to turn back towards Spider-Man, Darth Spider-Man, I had just passed. Darth Spider was standing right behind me, so close, it seemed like I could feel his breath. Coming from my blind spot, he stalked me in the stomach. Ooh, blind shot, kidney shot. All the tension dropped out of my body, and my vision went pitch black. Oh my god, are we the guy who's gonna get pregnant? After some time, I felt a searing pain in my abdomen. When my field of sight opened up again, I was in the operating room. Before me stood Hazuki Shino, her nurse's whites open, her stomach bloody. Though she was deathly pale, she gave me a kindly smile. In her hand was a scalpel. She slowly laid against my belly. Hazuki's hand pressed down. A rift appeared in my skin. Blood sprayed from the wound, catching onto Hazuki Shino's face. Even then, her smile remained pasted on. I watched, overwhelmed by dread and pain, as she gradually slashed me open. I had viewed this spectacle once before, when I read Hazuki's memories. In short, this was the pregnant man incident. The pain in my stomach was becoming unbearable. Screaming and crying, I tried to somehow escape by squirming, but my limbs were tied down on the bed, and I couldn't move away. Shaking myself made the pain in my abdomen grow still more intense. My skin cleanly sliced apart by his scalpel. Hazuki's fingers probed the opening from which blood overflowed. The simulation alone stabbed me with enough agony to shatter my brain. Her fingers writhed inside me, and the feeling of them came true to me clearly. And just as I had seen before in her memories, Hazuki forced my wound to open up on both sides. The sensation of skin and flesh ripping, taking it straight on, sans anesthesia. I and the possessor of the body in which I had entered lost consciousness, then soon woke again from an excess of pain. But Hazuki went on making the wound widen impossibly. I had long since stopped caring about little details, like which part of me hurt, about where in my body pain was erupting from. Illusion that all of my nerve endings were being pierced through my burning blah blah blah, and I passed out again. Whew. But I couldn't escape. The pain mercilessly forced me my consciousness awake, my body convulsed. If it meant being released from this suffering, I thought I'd be fine by biting my own tongue off. Next, Hazuki picked up a bloody fetus. It made her smile appear conversely revolting. This woman was insane. She took the remnants of the fetus she'd removed from her own body and plunged it into the depths of my stomach. Jesus. Her hand. Take my hand. And the fetus she held there shoved aside my innards, boring into me, gnawing deeper and deeper. I started to vomit blood, and it got caught in my throat. And even while I seemed about to suffocate from it, I went on emitting wheezing screams. Maybe because the pain had made my brain release too many neurotransmitters. My head felt weirdly vague, but the pain still didn't ease up, and I began to understand less and less of what was happening. Pain was all that controlled me. Hazuki withdrew her hand from my stomach and nodded with satisfaction. Oh, this is all automatic, she said softly, as if she were dealing with a patient, then abruptly fainted and collapsed in place. At almost the exact same time, somebody entered the operating room. The sound of his shoes rang out. But I had no interest in whoever it was, and went on bawling and shrieking, exposed to nothing other than excruciating anguish. Seeing the unnatural swelling of my abdomen, I panicked. Together with the pain, I had begun feeling a kind of an itchiness. It itched so bad. I wanted to scratch at the wound. But my hands were bound to the bed, and I couldn't do it. Suddenly, a shadow fell across my sights. Dark Spider had appeared, looming in front of me. He picked Hazuki up in his arms and left the operating room. Then, after some time, returned by himself. I didn't know what he was thinking. But he had a sewing needle and some fishing line with him. He had begun ponderously stitching... Okay, yeah, whatever. He was pretty sloppy at shit. Okay. Whew, man, I'm done with reading this shit. I gotta take a drink. Is this video going to be like 2 hours long? Itchy, scratchy, itchy. My God. Okay. Delicious. This Let's Play is sponsored by Cola. Oh, okay. Because of my mental state, it took me a while to notice that the scenery had switched at some point. The ache and the itchiness subsided minutely, but it didn't mean they had gone away completely. Now, even as I walked through this neighborhood of Shinsen, itchiness in the depths of my body, and the sensation of something forming in my abdomen, and a pain like having a fine needle plunging in and out all over my body. Oh yeah, this is the guy they found on the street. Okay. They stayed behind me as markedly as a tumor, continuing to psychologically torment me. A dark road with few people on it, located away from the heart of the city. Whoo boy, as I walked down it, I spotted a human figure coming my way. Since the road was narrow, we would have to angle ourselves sideways to pass one another. But I went cold when I saw the appearance of the figure walking toward me. It was that of Darth Spider-Man again. We crossed paths. Darth Spider displayed no particular reaction. My heart went into a tumult. An emotion resembling obsession rose at the back of my brain. A nasty old asshole had been hitting on my woman. It pissed me off. I wanted to kill him. That feeling, truly coming out of the left field, drove me into motion. The face of my woman was vague in my memory. I couldn't recall her clearly. It was doubtful that she even existed in the first place. Despite that, the face of nasty old asshole who'd been hitting on my woman appeared vividly at the back of my mind. I'd seen that face before. Strange! I've seen that face before! Alright, fuck it. Roll the clip. Strange. I've seen that face before. Okay. Yeah, welcome back. You know what? Let's just fucking call it here for today. That's enough of that. And we'll continue this on the next episode of Dragon Ball Z. I mean, what?